We'll try that again. Good morning, everyone. Happy Easter to each of you today. Hopefully you have been told that already, but if not, now you have. It's wonderful to be able to have you with us today and worshiping with us. Today is a very special day, not just because we have a drama that's going to be presented. Today is the day that we celebrate and we remember the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? And so with that, a happy Easter to you. We are going to begin our service by standing and singing and going to worship to the Lord. But let me ask you, if you would, join me as we go to Him in prayer before we kick things off. All right? Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we do thank You for today. We thank You for this wonderful occasion. Lord, every Sunday we get together and we worship You. We worship the name of Christ and we celebrate Your resurrection. But Lord, this is a day that we've set aside as one day out of the year, a special day when we remember what You have done for us and what it is that You desire to do through us. And so as we come together and we worship You today, Lord, we ask that Your Holy Spirit would fill this place, that You would have Your way among us and You would have Your way in us. And then as we leave this place, You would use us to continue to do Your will. And so, Lord, we ask You for these things, and we thank You for these things. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Good morning, and happy Easter again. If you would, please stand and join us for praise and worship. And as is customary in this house of worship, the altar is always open. So anytime you feel a need to come and bring a need or just to come and worship and pray, it's open for you.
Into glorious light. into glorious light. wanna be with you. Just wanna be with you. Yes, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. Yes, he loves us. Oh,
thank you. You may be seated. Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning.
Amen. Praise the Lord for his faithfulness towards us. And in just a few moments, we are going to be able to witness a dramatic presentation of what possibly could have been happening during the Lord's Supper or during the Last Supper. And before we do that, we need to give you a little bit of instruction on how things are going to work with our observance of the Lord's Supper today. Now, when you came in, hopefully everybody had the opportunity to be able to grab one of these little kits it's a cup with the bread on top of that. And first of all, I want to just give you a little bit of practical instruction with this. And then after that, I'll give you a little bit of spiritual instruction with it as well. So during this dramatic presentation, our disciple actors are going to be participating in the Last Supper with the actor for Jesus. And at that time, we are going to participate in the Lord's Supper as well. And some of you may have seen these little things before, some of you may have not. So just want to let you know when we get to the part of the drama where Jesus is passing out the bread to his disciples, you're going to open up your little wafer of bread, and that is the clear film on the top, the very top one. And then once he distributes the cup to his disciples, or he talks about the cup to his disciples, then you'll open the purple foil part, and then you'll have access to each of these, so that as the disciples are partaking of the bread, we will partake of the bread. As the disciples are partaking of the cup, we will partake of the cup. Is there anyone who did not get one of these when you came in through the doors. And we got one of our disciples back here that's going to bring that one of those to you if you need one. Is there anyone that did not receive one as you came in? All right, good. Oh, we got one up here. All right, and so now a little bit of a spiritual guidance, a little bit of spiritual advice here. One of the things that the Bible teaches us is that anyone who has placed their faith in Jesus Christ can participate in the Lord's Supper with us. We call this communion because this is experiencing being in the presence and being in communion with God. And so that is to be reserved for those that have a relationship with Christ, those that have placed their faith in Him. And so if you are a born-again believer, you've placed your faith in Jesus, then we invite you, we urge you to participate in this with us, regardless of whether you're a member of this church, whether you're a member of another church, or you're not a member of a church. If you have placed your faith in Christ, then we invite you to participate in this with us. And so we also would like to encourage you. Scripture also teaches us that many people experience sickness and even death. And Paul, in his teaching on the Lord's Supper, explained to them is because they were participating in the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner. So I just want to remind you before we get into this that we need to take an opportunity to make sure that we have confessed any known sin in our heart, in our life, so that we can seek forgiveness for that before we participate in observing the Lord's Supper. And so those are my instructions to you. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. We're going to allow you that opportunity to confess anything that you need to confess, and then we will move on into the drama, into the remaining part of our service. So if you would, please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you again for the way that you love us. Lord, you know us so well that you know the things that we need. And Lord, you even know the way that we need you to explain things to us so that we understand them. And Lord, you've given us this picture of your death for us to pay for our sin, pictured in the Lord's Supper. And so Lord, we thank you for that. Lord, we also come to you right now, and Lord, we confess sin that may be in our heart, sin that we are living out in our life. And Lord, you have convicted us of that. And Lord, so Lord, we confess that to you, and we ask you to forgive us of those things that we do that are against your will. And Lord, we just pray that as we will, in just a few moments, as we will be observing the Lord's Supper, Lord, we pray that you will bless the bread that you chose to represent your body. And Lord, that you would bless the cup which you used to represent your blood that was given on our behalf. And Lord, we pray that you would bless this occasion so that you will be glorified and you will be lifted up. And Lord, we ask you for that, and we thank you for that. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
The festival of the unleavened bread, which is called Passover, was fast approaching. Jesus sent a few of his disciples on ahead to make preparations for the supper. He told them, "When you've entered the city, a man carrying a water jug will meet you. Follow him to the house he enters. Ask the owner of the house to show you to the guest room where the master can eat the Passover with his disciples. He will show you a large furnished room upstairs." So they went and found it just as he had said. Let's listen as Philip, John, and Peter discuss their thoughts on on what happened.
I hope the master is pleased with the table.
Don't worry, Philip. He'll be very pleased.
Yes, I think we laid out a wonderful feast for tonight's Passover celebration.
It's just I'm unsure whether or not if the master is pleased with me. Peter, you and John are in his inner circle. I know he is pleased with you.
Sometimes, Philip, but even we make mistakes.
Philip, we're trying to be good disciples just as you are. I'm looking forward to many years of working with the master and becoming the disciple he wants us to be.
Yes, the future is as bright and hopeful as the night celebration. Come, John, let's go get the others.
When I sent you to prepare this Passover feast, I told you my time is at hand. I have looked forward to this hour with anxious and longing to eat this Passover meal with you before my suffering begins. For I tell you that I will not eat it again until what it represents has occurred in the kingdom of heaven. I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me this night.
Can you imagine the thoughts of the disciples at these words? Certainly, there was great confusion after hearing what Jesus said. They had all been optimistic of a bright future serving Jesus earlier in the day. And now the master says, one of his dear friends, one of his trusted servants will betray him. Perhaps their thoughts went something like this.
Nathaniel is my real name, although I'm also known as Bartholomew. I was born in Cana of Galilee, and like most of us, I was a fisherman. Philip and our close companions, and it was he who first brought me to Jesus. I will never forget the question I put to Philip that day. Can any good thing come out of Nazareth? For it was such a small, insignificant place. But after seeing Jesus, he said to me, behold, an Israelite in whom there is no guile. How do you know me, I asked. He answered, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. After hearing this, I had no doubt he is the Messiah. Since then, I have served him, walking the villages of Galilee, watching him turn water into wine, going down the streets of Decapolis, and finally the holy city of Jerusalem. And now, when he is instituting a ceremony to take place of the Passover, he tells us that one of us is to betray him. Who could it be? Could it be me? Could it be Nathaniel?
I was given the name Simon, Simon the Zealot. I was associated with a group of hot-headed and bloodthirsty rebels called the Zealots. We feared and hated the Romans and would settle for nothing less than their violent expulsion from our beloved land. I lived by the sword, and if not for Jesus, I would have died by the sword. One day I heard Jesus say, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. And you shall love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. I have unconditionally surrendered my will to Jesus, and I will follow him wherever he will lead. One day, through Jesus, we will bring our beloved land back to the glory God intended it to have. As I've watched Jesus conquer evil with love, I've realized how powerful love can truly be. I can overcome any adversity I face with love. And now he says there's a spiritual Roman among us, one that would try to take by force what can only be conquered through love. Could it be Matthew, the publican? Or John, the big fisherman? Or could he suspect me, since I am a former zealot? Could it be me? Could it really be me?
My name is James, but since I am younger than most of my other companions, I'm called James the Lesser. Thaddeus at the table and I are brothers, and together we first saw the Master on the day John the Baptist was baptizing him. I was curious to see what was happening, so I turned aside for a closer look. Then I saw Jesus asking John to baptize him. After Jesus was baptized by John, the heavens opened and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in the form of a dove. A mighty voice spoke, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Later, Jesus called me to be one of his disciples, and I have followed him ever since without hesitation. I have tried to learn about as much about him and his Heavenly Father as I could, but now he is speaking of one of us to betray him. It's surely madness to believe that one of us would do such a thing. But you know, I keep wondering, could it really be James the Lesser? Could it truly be me?
My real name is Judas Labius, but I didn't want to be associated with Judas Iscariot, so you can call me Thaddeus. I remember when Jesus called us to go out into the world and preach that the kingdom of God is at hand. He told us to be as wise as serpents and as innocent as doves, because he was sending us out into a world full of wolves. A few days ago, Jesus came into the city of Jerusalem, riding on a donkey, not as a king, but as a lamb to be sacrificed. Our king told us to look for a man with a pitcher, and we would know where the secret place for Passover would be. Now, I'm afraid for my safety, as well as the safety of my brothers, because Jesus told us there was a wolf among us and that one of us would betray him. Could it be Thaddeus? Could it be me?
I am Andrew, the brother of Simon Peter. I'm not a gifted man, just a simple fisherman. I've always done what I could to serve the Master. The others call me Andrew the Bringer, because it seems my talent is to bring others to Jesus. I brought my brother Simon Peter to Jesus, and I have watched with satisfaction the glorious transformation of his life. I also found the little boy with the 5 loaves and 2 fish the day Jesus fed the 5,000. Such miracles, such love and compassion the Master has for everyone. I've always been real close to the Master, certainly not one in the inner circle, but I do not wish to be. I only wish to serve him and to bring others to him so they can see he is truly the Lamb of God. What greater gift could life afford a simple fisherman than to be the friend and companion of his Master? But now he says one is to betray him? It's unthinkable. Who could it be? Could Andrew, the bringer, be the one to bring down his Master? Could it be me? Could it really be me?
My surname is Levi, but you know me as Matthew, the tax collector. Because of my profession, I have not known friendship or love. And then one day, a shadow fell across my collecting table. And I looked into the eyes of the Master. I saw a compassion I'd never seen in anyone else. And believe me, I've looked into the eyes of many men as they paid their due to the government. Follow me was the only words Jesus spoken. And I left my table and my life as a tax collector to follow him. And that was the biggest bargain of my life. I studied his life and how he's fulfilled the words of the prophets who foretold of his coming. I tried to write the exact words our master spoke. I exchanged my publican wretchedness for dignity of discipleship. I no longer collect taxes or make change. I watch Jesus change sinners into saints. You see, Jesus, he is the way, the truth, and light. And just as I'm writing the good news of his coming, he tells us bad news. One of his most trusted followers is to betray him. Could it be me, because I once was a tax collector? Is it me? Please tell me it isn't me.
I am Judas Iscariot, certainly the most trusted member of the Master's beloved society. I guess it was my past experience with the revolutionaries that led Jesus to choose me to follow him. Jesus is the Messiah. And one day he'll overthrow the Roman government and form a new kingdom of powerful messianic leaders. And I, the trusted treasurer of this group, will have the most powerful position. I will control the purse strings. True, for now, I dole out our scarce resources to the poor, but only because one day we will need them to follow the Messiah without any question. There have been times that the others have disagreed with my opinions. I still can't get over the waste of the precious perfume that Mary poured over Jesus' feet. You know how many pieces of silver that could have bought? Yeah, the master, he's showing signs of, shall I say, weakness. And I'm afraid that he may need a little prodding in order to complete his mission. Now he tells us that there's a betrayer among us. Well, I can tell you, it is not Judas Iscariot. No, I know my place, quietly manipulating things behind the scenes. And one day, he'll thank me for forcing his hand, for forcing the master to save himself at the very last minute. No, I am not the betrayer, but I'll go along with everyone else. I'll even act surprised. I might even ask, could it really be me?
My name is Philip. I came from Bethsaida in Galilee. Jesus called me to follow him one day when I was listening to John the Baptist preach. I was the fourth disciple chosen, and I brought Nathaniel to the master. During the years of close fellowship with Jesus, my faith has grown. When he fed the 5,000, I asked, where do we get enough bread that all these may eat? There, I realized our vision and power are so limited until the Master moves through us to reach the world with his love and compassion. I also know the Greek language really well, and they call me the Greek. And I arrange for the Master to speak with the Greeks. Through many years of close fellowship, I have come to understand the Master's words. And I am truly convinced that he who has seen the Father, seen Jesus, has seen the Father. And now he tells us that there is a traitor in our midst. Does this traitor not know in betraying Jesus he is betraying God? Who could it be? Could it be me, Philip? Could it really be me?
My brother Andrew and I were fishing one day when Jesus walked by and said, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. We immediately left our nets and followed him. He even gave me the name Peter, which means the rock. And when I confessed him as Christ, the Son of the living God, he said, upon this rock will I build my church. Strange that he would pick me, a hot-headed fisherman with a runaway tongue. Maybe it's my faith, for it is strong. For when I saw Jesus walking on the water, I tried to go to him. True, I lost confidence and began to sink, but my faith in him is unshakable until now. Tonight, when I promised to follow him anywhere, Jesus warned me that before the rooster crows twice, I will have denied him three times. He prayed for me because he said Satan want to sift me like wheat. Will I deny him tonight before the rooster crows? Will he deny me? Will he close the doors to the kingdom to me? Am I this betrayer he speaks of? If I knew who the scandal was that was going to do it, I would pierce his heart with this knife. But what if it was my own heart I pierced? Am I the one? Is it me? Is it me?
I have been given the nickname Doubting Thomas by those who know me. Since the days when I was a fisherman with Simon and Andrew, I have been cautious, careful, and certain of my actions. I usually demand proof before I believe. I want to see before committing myself. You see, I am not a man of doubt, rather I am a man of daring. When Mary and Martha sent word to the Lord that their brother Lazarus was dead, Jesus said, "Let us go to him." Some of the apostles were afraid to go because of growing opposition to Jesus. I was the one who spoke out and rebuked them all by saying, "Let us go with him, that we may die with him." Why do people overlook my daring and remember the doubting? Remember the questions, but overlook the affirmations. Jesus' enemies are determined to destroy him. Why? Because he reveals a greater God than the petty little man-made deities they have enshrined upon the altars of their hearts. Jesus would bring us all up to God, while all of his enemies would cut God down to their own size. And now, Jesus has brought doubt back into my heart when he says, "One of us is to betray him." Is he blaming me for lack of faith? Lack of courage? Is it I?
I remember the first time Jesus called to me. "John, me and my brother James were mending our nets on our father's boat when Jesus said, 'Come and follow us.' We were so excited, we dropped everything to go follow him. Since that day, I've tried to understand Jesus through his love, and that's hard for a man of my impetuous, fiery spirit to do. But the love of God has changed me. I'm now called the beloved disciple. The Lord once said, 'I'm the good shepherd, and the good shepherd will lay down his life for his sheep.' This is true sacrificial love. We don't understand what we go through, but I want everyone to know that no matter what, Jesus, he is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing in him, we may have eternal life. He said, 'For I call out to my sheep, and they hear my voice, and they know me.' But now he's told us that there is a betrayer at the table. Certainly it's not my brother or Andrew. Could it be John, the beloved disciple? Is it me?"
"I am James, the brother of John, and we have often been referred to as the Sons of Thunder. We were fishermen with our father Zebedee, and we were honored when Jesus wanted us as his disciples. I was present in Peter's home when Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law of her fever. Later, I watched as he raised Jairus' daughter from the dead. But the most astonishing event occurred on the Mount of Transfiguration when we saw Jesus talking with Moses and Elijah. Our mother urged us to petition Jesus to allow us to sit on either side of him in his kingdom. Jesus replied, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I am to drink, or be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" Jesus reminded us all that he would be first and always first. Must be servant of all, and he demonstrated his words by washing our feet. I have always tried to represent the highest power and strongest Christian quality, as is all, which would be love. And now, he who taught us the way of love is to be betrayed by one of those whom he loved? Who can it be? Why should one of us do such a thing? Is it me? Could it really be me?
Master, I'm sick at heart. I must know. Is it I?
The one who dips his bread in a bowl with me this night will betray me. What you are about to do, do quickly. I have wanted so much to eat this Passover meal with you before I suffer, for I tell you, I will never eat it again until it's fulfilled in the kingdom of heaven. This is my body, which is given for you. Take, eat, in remembrance of me. This is my blood, which seals the covenant, God's covenant. My blood poured out for the remission of sin. Take, drink.
At the end of the Passover feast, Jesus and his disciples went out to the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus prayed and then was betrayed, just as he had said.
This is the body, and this is the blood. For all of us, and in this communion, we share in his love. This is the body, and this is the blood. For all of us. This is the blood.
Amen. At this time, if we have any of our younger folks in the congregation, third grade and lower, if they would like to go to Children's Church, you can follow Miss Ree as she heads back. And those of you that are staying in here, if you would, please take your copy of God's Word and turn to the book of Mark, chapter 14. This morning, we've witnessed a dramatization of what may have taken place in the upper room on that night before Jesus was crucified on the cross for our sins. This is an event that we've come to know as the Last Supper. And we know that the Last Supper took place immediately before some of the other significant events in the life and the ministry of Jesus to the world that he loved so much. We know that as Jesus and his disciples left the upper room, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and they went to the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus prayed and called out to his Father because of the suffering that he knew was coming. And he asked his Father if there was any other way to redeem mankind, that be what they do. But he submitted himself to the Father and said, "Not my will, but your will." And we know that that is also the place where Judas came to Jesus and betrayed him and handed him over to the religious guards and to the Roman officials. One of his beloved disciples betrayed him. And then we remember of the next morning as Jesus faced a mock trial before the priest and then before Pontius Pilate, the Roman official. And we saw scenes in this video depicting Jesus carrying his cross down the Via Dolorosa. And then we saw scenes of him being crucified between two thieves. And we know after he was crucified on the cross and he spoke and he cried out that he had finished his work and he committed his spirit into the hands of God, we know that his body was placed in a borrowed tomb and he was buried and was there for 3 days. And although we remember those things, and those things are important, I want to tell you that we're not gathered here today to celebrate Jesus being in a tomb. We're here today not because he was crucified and he died and he was buried, but we're here today because he arose. We're here because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and that event is the most important, the most significant event throughout all of human history. And the resurrection changes how we live our life. It should affect everything about the believer's existence. You know, when we seek to serve Christ, it is because of the hope that we have in the resurrection. When we seek to obey Christ, it is because of the hope that we have in the resurrection. When we love people, and all of us fit this category, when we love people that are not easy to love, we only can do so because of the hope that we find in the resurrection. And so the resurrection plays a vital role in every aspect of Christian life. And that brings us back to the observance of the Lord's Supper. Why do we observe this ordinance within the church? Why did Jesus command us to continue doing this until he comes back? What is the connection between the Lord's Supper, Easter, and the resurrection? Well, over the next couple of weeks, we're going to be exploring this idea, this concept that Jesus gave us of the Lord's Supper. And today, I know that this dramatization has portrayed some ideas of what we think may have happened and what type of things might have gone through the minds of the disciples. So today, we're just going to kind of take some very brief, broad stroke views of this ordinance, the Lord's Supper. And I'm going to do this by taking a look at a couple of different passages of Scripture here from Mark chapter 14. The first thing I want to talk about is one particular thing that was happening before the Lord's Supper ever took place, to kind of set the scene for what's happening as we see the table laid before us. So if you will, follow along and read with me in verses 1 and 2 of Mark chapter 14. It says, "After 2 days it was the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a treacherous way to arrest and to kill him." Talking about Jesus. "Not during the festival," they said, "or there may be a rioting among the people." See, the Passover feast was approaching as we looked into these events and as Jesus told his disciples to go out and prepare for this feast. The Passover was quickly approaching. And in the Jewish calendar, there are three separate periods of feasting that happens every year. And this time of Passover is the first. This is the first feast of the Jewish calendar, the first feast of the year. And preparations had to be made ahead of time. And so that's why Jesus is telling his disciples, "Go and prepare this Passover meal so that I may have this meal and celebrate this meal with you." The lamb had to be chosen. A lamb had to be cooked. There are bitter herbs that had to be gathered together. The wine had to be bought. And everything had to be prepared ahead of time. And so Jesus wanted all these things to be ready so that he could celebrate the Passover with his disciples. So what was this Passover feast all about? You know, we celebrate Christmas and Easter, and we have these holidays that signify different things in the life of Jesus. But why do the Jewish people celebrate the Passover? See, it was a reminder of all the ways that God had delivered the Israelites. It was a time of celebrating who God was and what it was that he had done for them. But the religious leaders during this occasion saw the Passover feast not as a time of celebration, but as a hurdle to their plans, as a roadblock to get where they wanted to go. See, the feast prevented them from killing Jesus at this particular moment. So as it says in these first two verses, they were looking for an opportunity after the feast was done to put Jesus to death. And so that's what the Jewish officials were looking for. They were looking for this way to get Jesus. But Jesus was looking forward to this meal. Jesus was looking forward to this celebration. Luke's account of the Lord's Supper in chapter 22 says that Jesus fervently looked forward to this meal with them. Why was he looking forward to it, you might ask? Because Jesus knew his suffering that was about to begin. He knew that he was going to be separated from his disciples. He knew the pain and the torture that he was going to be going through. In fact, Jesus predicted on at least three different occasions that we find here in Mark alone, in Mark chapters 8, 9, and 10, three different times that Jesus told his disciples that I will be crucified and I will be betrayed. And so he anticipated this special time of worship and fellowship with the ones that he loved. That's what was taking place before this supper. Now let's look at verse 17, and this is going to describe what took place during the Lord's Supper. Verse 17 says this: when evening came, he arrived with the 12. While they were reclining and eating, Jesus said, "I assure you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be distressed and say to him one by one, "Surely not I." He said to them, "It is one of the 12, the one who is dipping bread with me in the bowl. For the Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born." As they were eating, he took bread, blessed it, and broke it. He gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them. And so they all drank from it. And he said to them, "This is my blood. This establishes the covenant. It is shed for many. I assure you, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it in a new way in the kingdom of God." After singing psalms, they went out to the Mount of Olives. There are three different statements made in this passage of Scripture that I wanted to just take a moment to look at. The first one is Jesus telling his disciples, when he's talking about the bread, he says, "This is my body." Now, as we said, Jesus has already told them that his death was coming, that his crucifixion was coming, but they didn't understand it. They didn't understand how Jesus could set up his kingdom here on earth if he was going to die. And so they didn't understand, and he again is telling them what would happen. But he's also instituting a new agreement, a new covenant between God and his people. See, before, their covenant was based upon their ability to obey and to keep the law. But now, Jesus and his new covenant is to be based on that sacrifice of him giving of himself to be broken for us. Isaiah 53, verses 4 and 5 says, "Yet he himself bore our sickness, and he carried our pains, but we in turn regarded him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was pierced because of our transgressions. He was crushed because of our iniquities, punished for our peace. And we are healed by his wounds." When we see the images of Jesus beaten and bruised and broken on the cross, it brings ache to our heart, but it should also bring joy to know that he has bought our healing and he has bought our salvation. The second statement that Jesus makes is, "This is my blood." And not only did Jesus have to die in our place, but he also had to take away our sin. See, it wasn't enough just that he died on the cross to take our place, but there had to be something done about our sin, our condition before God, because God cannot allow sin into his presence. This was the second part of this covenant that Jesus was creating. See, it's his blood that allows us to be forgiven. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22 says, "Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin." And that remission means forgiveness. You know, when we think about the word remission in our day and age, we think about this disease called cancer. And we think about how when people are treated for cancer and the treatments work, we say that that person, their cancer is in remission. I'm going to tell you, there's a greater disease than cancer. There is a more awful disease than cancer that every single human being is infected with. And that disease is called sin. And it is at the core cause of every other problem and every other disease that we face in this life. But the blood of Jesus Christ allows for the remission of sin. The blood of Jesus Christ, when applied to our life and applied to our heart, it eradicates that disease, the effects of that disease on our life and, more importantly, on our eternity. But it must be applied. No medicine, how good it worked, no matter how good it works, is not effective if it's not taken and it's not applied. And then the third phrase that I wanted to focus on from this passage of Scripture was one that Scripture says that each one of the disciples asked themselves. We don't know whether they asked this out loud. We don't know if this was just a thought within their head as we saw portrayed today. But each and every one of them made the statement, "Surely not I." Each disciple, when it came to their relationship with Jesus, they asked themselves this question, "Surely it can't be me. Surely it's not me that will betray my Savior." Each and every one of them were concerned that they were guilty. And you know, we often think about those events, and we think Judas is the one who was guilty. Judas is the one that betrayed Jesus. But the truth of the matter is that every single one of us is guilty. Every single one of us betrays Jesus. That's why it is my sin that placed Jesus on that cross. It was your sin that placed Jesus on that cross. But I also want to remind you, it's Christ's love for you that put him on that cross. That's how much Jesus loves you. That's how much God the Father loves us. That he was willing to give up his son. And Jesus loves us so much that he willingly endured the pain that he endured and a shameful death upon the cross because he loves you that much. And then after the Lord's Supper, we're going to flip over to chapter 16. We're going to fast forward from the upper room. We go out to the Garden of Gethsemane. Judas comes and he betrays his Lord with a kiss. And he is arrested by the priests and the temple guard. And he faces that mock trial before them and before Pilate. And he is crucified on that cross and he is buried in that borrowed tomb. And then we come to Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 6. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so they could go and anoint him. Very early in the morning, on the first day of the week, they went to the tomb at sunrise. They were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone from the entrance of the tomb for us?" Looking up, they observed that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. And when they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a long white robe sitting on the right side, and they were amazed and alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he told them. "You're looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, who was crucified." And then words that changed the course of history. "He has been resurrected. He is not here." Amen? He is not in the tomb any longer. This is the core of Easter. This is why we celebrate this day. He is no longer in the tomb. He is risen. He is alive. And he is our resurrected Savior. And you know, the most astounding thing about this, not just that he arose from the grave, because that proves that he is God. The most astounding thing about this to me is that not only did Jesus arise from the dead, not only is he resurrected, but Jesus promises that if I believe in him, I will be resurrected as well. That just amazes me. He offers that same resurrection power to anyone who places their faith in him. And so our musicians are going to come and they're going to play a song that we're going to sing. But I want you to understand that while they're playing this song and while we're singing along with them, I want you to know that this is your opportunity to respond to whatever Jesus may be speaking to you right now, whatever the Holy Spirit may be saying to you. Because I want to ask each and every one of you, we talked about how these disciples each asked, is it me? The Scripture teaches us that every single one of us play a part in Jesus dying on the cross. Every single one of us have a little bit of that guilt. But because of Jesus' love, every single one of us has an opportunity to experience that resurrection. And so I want to ask you today, as we sit here in this sanctuary and we hear this music playing and we're called to kind of reflect on our own life, I just want to ask you, are you certain? Are you sure beyond any shadow of a doubt that you've placed your faith in the sacrifice of Jesus Christ to be what gets you into heaven? Have you made certain that that is the only thing you're trusting in to save you from your sins? Because I can tell you that's the only thing that works. Scripture tells us that he is the only way of salvation. Do you know that there's a moment in your life when you came to Jesus and you confess the fact that you have sin in your life, that you've broken God's law, that you've broken his heart, and you come to him and you asked him to forgive you of your sins? Do you know that there is a time in your life when that has happened? If you know that, then praise the Lord for his forgiveness. Thank him for his forgiveness. Feel free to come and kneel at this altar and worship him through bowing before him. But if you don't have that certainty, if you can't say with surety that there has been a time when you've asked Jesus to forgive you and give you eternal life, I encourage you, I invite you, I beg you, come to him now. Confess him as your Savior. Confess your sins and ask him for that forgiveness. And he will grant you that resurrection power. And he will give you that certainty that when you leave this world, we don't know when that time will come for any of us, but he will give you that certainty that when you leave this world, you will enter into his kingdom for all of eternity. And so I'm ask you, go ahead and stand, even though we're not singing just yet. Go ahead and stand. And I encourage you, if you have that certainty, you know that you're a child of God, you know that you've been forgiven, then I encourage you, if the Holy Spirit's leading you to, you go ahead and you come and you kneel down at this altar and you go to him and you praise him, you thank him for what you do not deserve. And if you're here today and you do not know him, I encourage you to join these folks here at the altar and you go to him and you ask for that forgiveness and you ask him to give you eternal life. Or maybe you've got some other need on your heart. Maybe there's sickness in your family. There's something else that you need to come and you need to bow down before him. You go ahead and do that. Whatever your need is, bring it to this altar as we sing.
I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Shine through the shadows and burn like Cause your name is power, and your name is healing, Lord. Your name is life. Oh, and break every stronghold, and shine through the shadows, and burn like a fire.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you right now just to thank you. Thank you for your body that was broken for us. Thank you for your blood that was shed to pay for our sins. Lord, we thank you for your love for us and your desire to have a relationship with us, to be in communion with us. And so, Lord, that is why we worship you. That is why we worship you, because of how great you are and how compassionate you are towards us, how merciful you are towards us. And so, Lord, we love you and praise you with all that we have. And, Lord, as we come to this time of the service where we worship through giving back to you, Lord, we pray that you would accept these tithes. And we pray that you would accept these offerings that are given above and beyond our tithes. And you would receive them as a sacrifice. You would receive them as worship. And you would use them to continue to grow your kingdom, to allow us to exalt the name of Jesus Christ and do your will on this earth. And Lord, we ask you for that and we thank you for that. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Now you guys can have a seat, and our men that are going to help with receiving this offering of worship through giving, and they'll go ahead and join us at this time.
Sometimes I fall to my knees and pray. Come, Jesus, come. Let today be the day. Come, Jesus, come. And come, Jesus.
Want to share a couple of announcements with you before we head out. Before we do that, though, can you let all of these folks that participated in our drama, just let them know how appreciative you are of them? And I also want to let you know it wasn't just the men that were up here actually saying these words. There were folks behind the scenes that were doing decorating and getting props ready
and baking bread
and all of these things and directing these men. You know, if you get a bunch of men like that together, you know there's got to be a woman telling them what to do. So we do appreciate those folks as well. I'm not going to mention names because I don't know that I know who all had a part in getting things ready, but we do thank each and every one of you who had a part in that. All right, so our announcements. You see that we are finishing up the month of March, and we're participating in our Annie Armstrong Easter offering. If you have not had an opportunity to be able to participate in that, please feel free to do that. And if you plan to do it today and then you just got here this morning and you realize, oh, I forgot to bring it, you can bring it with you next time or mail it to us. If we get it in next month, we'll still send it, and they'll still take it, and they'll still use it to help our missionaries, North American missionaries. This is where this offering money goes to. So make sure you participate in that. Our church goal is $5,000. And this evening, we will not be having evening services today. Use this time to go spend with family, celebrate Easter, and tell somebody about Jesus. Tell them that he is risen, that he is no longer in the grave, that he is alive. So make sure you tell folks that. Coming up April the 13th, we will be having a family movie night. We're still discussing which movie we're going to be showing, but we're going to have that. It begins at 6:30, so put that on your calendar. Make plans to be there. And April the 5th, that's this coming, that's Friday and Saturday, correct? For the, our brotherhood is going to be getting together, and they're going to be building a deck on the 5th, and then they'll be coming together on the 6th, and they'll be building a wheelchair ramp. If you have any questions about that or have any comments or want to just let them know that you're going to be a part of that and you plan on coming, please let Mr. Kevin know. Raise your hand there, Mr. Kevin. Let Mr. Kevin know that you're planning to be there. All right, our next slide there is one that you have seen plenty of times before, but we have some folks that are fairly new to our church, and they may not know about it, or maybe you knew about it, but you've forgotten to get ready for it. But I want to let you know that there is a resource that the church has paid for to make available to you to be able to receive Bible studies. Most of these are video-based Bible studies. Many of these we do in our small group Bible studies that we have here at the church. But it's free to you. Church has already paid for it. You just have to go sign up for it. And so if you'll use that code there, if your phone won't work with taking it off of the screen there, let me know, and I'll get you the link to it. But all you have to do is give them your email address, create a password, and you have access to all of these Bible studies that we do, plus about 20,000 more. So take advantage of that if you have not already. And we're going to be announcing soon something big coming up with our small groups that you're going to want to be a part of. And so in order to do that, you need to have access to Right Now Media. So if you haven't signed up for that, make sure that you do that before too long. All right, and our next slide is a reminder about our Vacation Bible School. These are the dates for our Vacation Bible School, July 7th through the 12th. And there's still plenty of places to volunteer and to work. If you'd like to do that, there's a sign-up sheet out in the foyer. Make sure that you get that done and bring us your empty washed cans, soup cans, vegetable cans, whatever, and we're going to put those to use with our decorations. All right, is there anything else that I have forgotten to announce? Anything that I've missed? Yes, I think I had forgotten about that. Also, we've got Bible studies that we have on Sunday nights. We've got some ladies groups that meet Wednesday. We had been meeting on Wednesday night and some other times of the day. And at that time, the men said, "Well, what about us? You know, do we have a Bible study that's designed for men?" Well, we do. That Bible study is going to be starting Tuesday at 6:30. So make plans to be here for our men's Bible study. Anything else that I've forgotten to mention? All right. Yeah, do continue to pray for our missionary, Miss Carly, and just to okay. And to pray for Miss Carly, but just to kind of give you a little bit of an update, we had a love offering for her to help her once she gets home from Mexico. I think like the very next week we leave to go to Honduras, and she's planning to go with us. And some of you gave towards a love offering to help make sure that happened. We were able to raise $710 to help Miss Carly with that, and so we're going to make sure that she has at least half of that trip cost going to be covered. And so we're looking forward to that, and thank you for that as well. One last thing: your cups from the communion that we observed just a little while ago, just take those with you as you head out. And there's going to be, our men have placed a couple of trash cans at each exit there, and just drop those in the trash cans as you head out. All right, anything else that I forgot? All right, yes, ma'am. Okay, Feed the Few is on the 13th. That's a Saturday morning at what time? 10 o'clock, all right? All right, will you write that on there so I can make sure to announce it next time? Not going to do it on 13th? Okay. All right. Anything else? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer as we get ready to head out. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the privilege of being able to be here today to worship you, to sing your praises, and Lord, just to remind each other of the hope that we have in your resurrection. And Lord, as we leave this place, Lord, we pray that we would go out, we would be joyful, faith-filled followers of Christ, and we would tell others about this hope in your resurrection. Lord, we ask you for that, and we thank you for that. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Happy Easter.